Hello and welcome to a webinar hosted by the Desert Landscape Conservation Cooperative. This is Ken Nowak with the Bureau of Reclamation, and we're very pleased to have Drew Decker and Joel Osuna talk to us about the National Hydrography Dataset. Thank you everyone for joining us today, and thank you to our presenters for sharing this work with us. I'm now going to turn it over to our presenters, and please remember, we'll do questions at the end. Thank you.
Hi, this is Drew Decker with the US Geological Survey. Joel Osuna and I will be talking today about this project on National Hydrography Dataset updates for the DLCC area. We're going to be switching between our slideshows and computers a little bit as we go, so please be patient with that. And really, without any further ado, I'll go ahead and jump into this. I'm in San Diego, California. I'm a geospatial liaison for Southern California and Arizona. I also work with Carol Ostrogan, who is the liaison for Nevada, Northern California. She's been working very heavily with this project as well, but it's out on travel this week. So I'll cover the USGS portions of this. And Joel and I, again, will be switching off between our different computers here. Okay, this project, as you can see by the logos on the bottom, is involving several different groups. USGS, we manage the National Hydrography Dataset. That's a surface water layer for the United States. And I'll say a few more words about that in a moment. Joel's with Center for Geographical Studies, and he may say a little bit more about what he and his group do up there. And of course, on the right there, you can see we're doing work on behalf of Desert Landscape Conservation Cooperative. Both USGS and Fish and Wildlife Service have provided some funding towards these edits for the National Hydrography Dataset work that's being carried out by Northridge. Okay. Our presentation outline is as follows, a little bit of an overview. I'm going to start on the NHD data stewardship overview in just a moment, show you a couple other slides for that. Then we'll talk about the update project objectives and the scope. Joel will talk mainly about that. He will also go into the next bullet, the current status of the project. Then he'll have a couple of demos of work completed under task one. He has some business rules that he's going to show you. He's going to show you some examples of the way the data used to look, the way the data look now. Then there's two other tasks to look at. There's tasks two and three, which we're beginning. And I will say a little bit more about task two, which involves integrating springs data into the National Hydrography Dataset. Joel will talk more about task three, which are the broader scope of edits across the region. And then we will wrap up with a little bit of information on some details on Forest Service as well as a reclassification of certain streams that USGS is doing, okay? I'm gonna jump out of this presentation and open up my other one here. And this is going to be a little bit of background information. Hopefully you can see the blue background now. This is going to introduce everybody to the National Hydrography Dataset. I don't know how familiar everyone is with this data set, so this will give you just a little bit of background of what this is all about and lead into what we're trying to do as Joel then describes the different tasks of the project. Okay, so NHD, it's the nation's hydrographic network, and it's part of the National Map. National Map is a suite of digital map products that USGS has been making for quite some time. You can see here the little illustration showing some a selection of different streams. We'll get a little more information here if we look at what composes this. Okay, so what is the National Hydrography Data Set? It's essentially the surface water features found on topographic maps. Okay, so here's a little static image showing you the components. This is surface water. It doesn't have groundwater. The closest thing we have to groundwater, we do have wells, we do have springs, but we don't have aquifers, for example, and underground information like that. So we have streams are all shown here in blue. You can see the lakes, of course. Other conveyances carrying water on the surface, such as canals and ditches, are shown. Certain water infrastructure is in there, such as diversion tunnels, dams, stream gauges that USGS monitors. So it's all shown together as kind of a collection of surface water features. It's all networked together too. I'll say more about that in a moment, but you can see here Look at the collection of black arrows on here. This is showing the stream direction. So think of this in a way like it's a road layer, right? You have different roads or routes that water can travel. It's got a direction, like traffic can go in. And so this is a networked collection of surface water, okay? So the fundamental network begins with streams. We have several different types of streams. For example, here's a stream called Swan Creek. These streams, by the way, have fairly minimal attributions. So there's not too many attributes tied to each one. Again, the main thing is to convey the location of the water feature. However, names are important. We have any names that are part of the geographic names information system, kind of the federal database of names. If it relates to a water feature, we will include it in NHD. So Swan Creek is one of those. Next, we have other streams all tied together. We have different types of streams as well. Perennial means that typically water flow throughout the year. Intermittent means that the water flow is only for part of the year, often tied to perhaps irrigation usage or to a snowmelt runoff or a rainy season or something like that. Ephemeral are streams that hold water only immediately after rainfall. So they'll fill up with water after a rainstorm. Once it drains off and the area dries up, then it typically won't have any water left in it. Flow direction, again, providing direction to the data, okay, showing you how the water can move so we can route with this. The network does go through water bodies. You can see here we have artificial paths, which are shown in red, so that you can link water that's above the lake to water that's below it. So you can know where, so you could have an event here and you can relate it to something on the other side of the water body. Linear referencing, the NHD has, besides names of streams, it'll have a certain ID or reach code, which really has its origins with EPA. And its reach then is, you can think of as kind of a name for these rivers, whether it has a true name or not. And thus, with this, we're able to calculate sort of a location on these, given its reach code and a percentage along the reach, to come up with a quasi-address for a stream. Okay, data events, because this is an integrated network, we can take, we can relate items near the water features to the water features. So we have a stream gauge, for example. We can essentially move it here to the stream feature and thus relate other things to it. Looking a little broader here, you have a stream gauge. You can relate that to things that are occurring on the river, okay? Things going above it, things below it as well. Okay. One thing we'll talk a little bit about today are watersheds, because those define the areas in which NHD data are both organized and thus updated as well. And so we are updating certain watersheds across the country or for this DLCC project. And thus you can see some outlines here of, these are smaller watersheds, something called the Watershed Boundary Dataset, which helps define the NHD content. Okay. And thus summing it all up here, because we have this integrated surface water data, we can not only use it to map, not only to the basic mapping and cartographic and GIS data set, but you can also use it to relate data along this network. So in this case, things upstream can be related to happening downstream and vice versa. So that's kind of it in a nutshell. And I believe we can go ahead and move into the next part of the project. Real quick, Arizona, by the way, we do have stewards that work on the data. In this case, acting kind of on behalf of our agency and DLCC, Fish and Wildlife in this case, we have California State University doing some work. We don't really have a state steward in Arizona. Some states have stewards, some do not. I'm the liaison for the area. We have a USGS point of contact, and Bill Smith in our RALA office. So we have a little website that allows people to find out what's going on with NHD in any given state. And so now, though, person doing the work now really is Joel and his group. And I will go ahead and turn it over to him. Okay. And Joel, can you go ahead and start, or should I just drag the ball over to you here?
I'll try to go ahead and share my screen.
Okay. I think we see it.
Great. So thanks, Drew, for that great overview. Kind of sets the stage for this project, especially because this project is very heavily oriented in using the NHD and oriented towards improving the NHD. So what we would like to do is provide you all with an overview of this project scope and objectives. Then what we're going to do is go into a little bit more detail, like Drew mentioned, into what we're producing, what the current status of the project currently looks like, and then some other related NHD items that kind of have some overlap with this current project and the current efforts coming out of this project. So this project is formed via a partnership between the US Geological Survey, the US Fish and Wildlife Service, with the Desert Landscape Conservation Cooperative, the DLCC, and then the Center for Geographical Studies at California State University, Northridge. The principal objective of this project is to comprehensively improve the NHD at the 1 to 24,000 scale for key areas within the DLCC geography. And those key areas being selected by the DLCC and their partners. When we use the term comprehensive, we refer to updating all of the components of the NHD, including the point, the lines, and the polygon features, and not necessarily just the or just select components of the NHD. So we are conducting, a portion of this project is dedicated to conducting comprehensive updates to all NHD features. So this project has a general overview or general overarching objective, which is to, again, bring updates to the NHD, which then would directly result in a more robust and accurate hydro data set that can be used to support the science objectives of the DLCC, its partners, and then also by extension, since the NHD is available to the public and other agencies that may be doing work in the geography. This data set offers an updated inventory of surface hydro features and can also be or serve as the basis for a hydro model or be used as a hydro model to carry out those specific objectives and science as well. Additionally, this project, like I mentioned, this project makes the NHD available to the public, so it's done through a stewardship system set up by the USGS. So we acquire an extract of the data where the data is to be updated, and then the updated data, those updates, those improvements are then checked back into the USGS's national database, which again, as Drew mentioned before, is available to the public via that national the national map system. On a more technical end, this project will provide us with the opportunity to develop and further refine hydro mapping rules, especially those pertaining to features in arid regions. These rules are not only used to standardize the NHD improvements and updates for arid regions, but also help standardize and add consistency to future work, especially future work within arid regions. And that's very important, especially when it comes to NHD, considering NHD is not necessarily just a regional data set, it's a nationwide data set. It's very important to move in a direction where we have standards that can be implemented across the board to add to the data set's quality. Should also mention now that the project's timeline, the project started in October of last year, and it's currently set to conclude October of this year. So what you see on the screen right now is hopefully gives you a better idea if you're not already familiar with it. This is the DLCC, boundary, their main area of interest. Just to kind of put it into perspective, since we'll be talking about the areas that we are updating the NHD within this this greater geography. And as you can see on the slide as well, we have three main tasks under this project. Tasks 1 and 3 are very similar to each other. We'll go into more detail about that in a second. They mainly deal with bringing updates or executing comprehensive updates, as I mentioned, to certain key areas within the DLCC area. And then task 2 is a spring integration and improvement task. And we'll talk about these in a little bit more detail coming up. All right, so to talk a little bit more about task 1, under task 1, we're bringing updates to the NHD within the lower Colorado River Basin. And to be more specific, the DLCC has selected a watershed. It's the Imperial Watershed. That is that equates to about 3,700 square miles. My apologies. And the task currently to date is about 50% complete. This includes going through the checkout process and going through the various quality control phases that need to be done before the editing. And now through the editing is currently in progress. So all in all, this task is about 50% complete. I should note that this area is very large compared to other watersheds that are potential watersheds to be updated and just typical watersheds. It's a very large area, and we'll give you guys a visual of that in a second. Task 2 is a spring integration and improvement task, which will be integrating new springs into the NHD and or updating current NHD springs that are within the NHD using reference data. And Drew will discuss this task in a little bit more detail later on in the webinar. Task 3, like I mentioned before, is very similar to task 1 in that it also will bring comprehensive NHD updates, but for other areas of importance as selected by the DLCC. The total area allocated to this task equals 7,100 square miles, and just last month, DLCC was able to lock in 4 watersheds in the Transboundary Madryn area. This is an area that that covers Arizona and other areas, but as you'll see in the graphic that we have for you, the areas that were selected within Arizona. So they've gone ahead and locked in 4 watersheds to receive updates. And we've started that work early this month, so that work is also underway. I should also note that because there are 7,100 square miles allocated to this task, the sum of the areas that have been selected and kind of locked in by DLCC doesn't necessarily equate to that total quite yet. So there's about 1,200 square miles that still remain need to be allocated to a specific watershed or a portion of a watershed under this task. So that's something that still needs to be ironed out in the near future as this project progresses. And then lastly, this task does exclude U.S. Forest Service lands, just because the U.S. Forest Service will be doing a separate effort, even though there is some overlap in efficiencies. And we'll touch on that in a slide later on towards the end of the webinar. So that gives you an overview of the 3 different tasks that we are undergoing under this project. Let me switch back to the previous slide really quickly. So again, just to reiterate, task 1 and task 3 are bringing comprehensive NHD updates. Again, we're updating polygons, lines, and points within the NHD, whereas task 2 is only bringing updates to springs, springs being represented by point features within the NHD. So if we isolate tasks 1 and 3, again, those tasks that reflect those comprehensive updates, here's a summary table that shows you the different watersheds that have been selected for each task. And again, it kind of summarizes what I've already mentioned. If you see here under task 1, that Imperial Reservoir Huck is fairly large compared to the other reservoir selected under task 3. So that's a big point that I want to get across, is that this first huck is very large compared to the subsequent hucks that have been selected. And again, just touching on this topic or this item again, is that there's still there's been 7,100 square miles that have been allocated under task 3, but currently about 5,900 have been allocated. So there's still some area remaining to be allocated under task 3. And we'll talk about that and put it into a better framework or better perspective when we talk about the other tasks of the project and kind of some options that have kind of surfaced. So here's our first graphic, which shows you the area that, the general area that we are conducting updates to the NHD in. And the dotted line, the thick dotted line here is the DLCC area boundary. And within here, obviously, we have areas within California, Arizona, New Mexico. You'll see this first watershed is that first watershed under Task 1 that is receiving NHD updates. And then over here to the east in southeastern Arizona, we have the four Task 3 watersheds that are currently now receiving updates. I should also note that the U.S. Forest Service lands are depicted here in the green color. And that's something that'll be significant later on when we bring up the U.S. Forest Service lands and potential work coming out of there. So here is a closer look at the Task 1 watershed. Again, this is the Imperial Reservoir watershed. You can see here just by looking at the aerial photo that we have in this graphic that there's quite a variety in terms of the land cover types that are present here. There's some agricultural areas, areas with relief that are a little bit more mountainous, and then barren desert as well. So it does offer us a really good opportunity as a starting point, given that this is the first HUC that we started working on for this project, to kind of set the stage and give us a good taste of the different types of land cover that we can expect in these arid regions. Here's a closer look at the Task 3 watersheds. Again, these are the ones that are clustered in southeastern Arizona. And similar to that first watershed, we have similar land cover types, however, to varying degrees or different degrees. Here we have less agriculture overall, and then we have some more mountainous areas and some more barren areas. But overall, the composition is more or less the same as the composition of that first watershed that we're working on. And again, you can see the U.S. Forest Service lands are adjacent and sometimes overlapping these watersheds. I don't have the watershed outlines going into the U.S. Forest Service lands, but there is overlap here, and there are other forest lands that are adjacent to these watersheds. Okay, so what we would like to do now is demo some of the work that we have completed under Task 1. And first up are the business rules. I'm not going to go into too much detail regarding these because these can get pretty technical. There's a lot of detail that goes into these to developing business rules for mapping hydro features within the arid regions that we're updating. So I'm not going to get into too many technical details, but I do want to just give you a taste of what kind of rules we've come upon that have kind of determine the types of rules that we have developed or further refined for this project, again, in terms of hydro mapping and updating hydro data. So we have rules that cover wash fan delineation that allow our editors to identify and define the differences between wash features and fans. That's something that we've come across in this project pretty often. That is a problem, again, that needed to be addressed and standardized in the way that we map those features. Seasonality is also a big one, especially when we're mainly dealing with imagery as a primary reference data set for this project. We had to set rules to make sure that our end product was consistent and standardized across the board. So we ended up developing seasonality rules. When it came to densifying flow lines, we'll have an example of this later on, by the way. But when we ended up densifying flow lines, there were a large number of ephemeral channels that were not represented in the NHD. And again, as Drew mentioned, ephemeral channels are those that are the most driest. They only contain water during rainstorm events or during the immediate runoff of those events. So there was a lot of ephemeral channels that we noticed that were present in the aerial photos that we were assessing, but were not accounted for in the NHD. So we had to set threshold limits, especially for those smaller ephemeral channels that likely experience seasonal change. We didn't want to end up mapping something that from season to season will have a change in its course or its shape. So we ended up setting thresholds for when we map ephemeral channels. and when we add them into the NHD. We also have rules for accounting for submerged streams and other trickier features that may be a little bit more difficult to map. Again, our goal was to set standards just to make sure that the data was consistent across the board and that the mapping was executed consistently across the board. So in addition to accounting for submerged streams, we also accounted for washes and wetland features within arid regions. And yes, there were wetland features that we found in that first huck. Even though this is an arid region, we do have perennial channels like the Colorado that that does have adjacent wetland features, and then of course the washes that feed into those perennial channels. So again, kind of the takeaway from this is that our goal is in updating the NHD, we want it to be as consistent as possible. So we developed business rules, and we're currently still in the phase of developing additional business rules as needed. Again, with the focus of developing a good product at the end of the day. So here we're going to show some before and after examples. So the befores, you'll see, show the NHD as it was checked out before we started working and making improvements to the NHD. So in this example, you'll see the Colorado River, and we have several areas that have washes depicted here. So we have a vegetated wash here. You can see kind of the braided channels in here. And it's a little bit more difficult to see here, but there are some wetland areas that do have more herbaceous, more spongy vegetation that are wetter that were not captured and accounted for in the NHD. So this is the before shot, and this is the after shot, and you can see the outline of these areas, of these features, have been now integrated and added into the NHD. You can see this dotted pattern accounts for wetland features. Swamp marsh features is what the NHD calls them. And we use the National Wetlands Inventory data to help support our decision making here when we capture wetlands. And then again, like I mentioned in the previous section, we also have rules that help us consistently delineate when to capture washes and decision makings pertaining to that. We'll have a more hands-on example of an area very similar to this in just a minute. So here what you'll note is that we have an area with several washes that are depicted in the screenshot. You'll see kind of the sandy soil here that's very different from this area that has more relief here. So you'll see this is an area with a wash, this is another wash. So there's no, in the original version of the NHD, which is what you're seeing here, there are no polygons, or there were no polygons representing these features. In addition to that, it's clear that some of these washes did end up draining out to the Colorado here, or a branch of the Colorado, this perennial channel. But in some cases, you'll see here these washes, or these ephemeral streams, they just abruptly end here. Here's another example. Here's another example where there's a lack of connectivity there. So that's the before shot. This is how the after shot looks like. And you can see we've added polygons representing those wash features. And in addition, we've also extended those flow lines and made sure that where there's connectivity, that they ended up being connected to this perennial channel. So if analyses regarding upstream tracing or flow accumulation, or if you wanted to relate some point that's downstream of this perennial and have all the associated tributaries to this perennial channel, that can now be conducted after these updates have been carried out, because again, we've accounted for that connectivity and improved the data in that manner. These are pretty basic example. This example will demonstrate the densification of streams or flow lines, as the NHD calls them. This is essentially just the addition of flow lines that are depicted on the aerial photos, but again, are not present currently in the NHD. This goes back to the business rule I kind of touched on briefly earlier, that we had to set threshold limits for adding ephemerals. These flow lines, even though they're very dry, they're all considered ephemeral. They only likely have water when there's a rainstorm event. They're very dry, but some of them are pretty large. Here we're at a scale of 1 to 50,000. So if we were to zoom in more, some of these would be pretty prominent in the landscape. So we made sure we accounted for those, and this is how the after shot looks like after we went ahead and densified the area. You can see lots of ephemerals were added. Again, still following our threshold limits there. Again, densifying the data, making it more robust, and accounting for those features that are permanent in the landscape that should be reflected in the NHD to make the NHD more usable and higher quality. Okay, so I'm really quickly going to switch over to my ArcMap document. This is my GIS data here that I have. Show you guys a just a quick live demo of the data. This is a data, or this is a, an area again within that Imperial Reservoir subbasin that has received updates and is currently 50% complete. I wanted to go back to that example specifically about the wetland areas, the swamp marsh areas, that as they're called in the NHD. I'm going to turn off my layers here and show you how we do have kind of this this feature here with water. It's an isolated feature. It's not necessarily connected to the Colorado. It's broken off here. So it is isolated, and it doesn't necessarily have flow, so it's represented as a lake pond feature in the NHD. It's almost like an oxbow, if you will, an oxbow lake. But if you look carefully here, there are areas, let me bring my pointer back here, there are areas that have, that look wetter, they're darker. They do have spongier vegetation within them. And they contrast other areas like these areas right here that have more scrub shrub vegetation. So we notice in the NHD, these areas were not accounted for. They did not have a polygon drawn here at all. So what we did is we made sure that those wetland areas were accounted for. And you can see the outline here of these polygons. They're accounted for now as swamp marsh type. And again, accounting for where there's emergent vegetation, where there's likely regular inundation. And again, the aerial here basically screams out to us that that there is a difference between between those wetter areas and those drier areas that have more scrub shrub vegetation. So we made sure we accounted for those. And then going back to the washes as well, let me switch back to NHD area here. You can see lots of washes. I'll go ahead and just turn that off. You can see lots of areas here that show washes, dry washes coming in that were not in the NHD before. So again, we made sure we accounted for those, and we added them in as polygon features using that wash type. And then, of course, we also, like I showed in the last example, made sure that the connectivity of flow lines are represented there. So we do have flow lines that are not necessarily always embedded in the wash. They're also outside of the wash that contribute water to those wash systems, but now there's connectivity between those upstream features through the wash and then down into the other flow of these more perennial wetter features as well. Okay. So I'm going to pass the PowerPoint back to Drew so he can talk about the Springs integration a little bit more. Drew, can you take it away? Let me go ahead and just see if I could pass the privileges.
I think I can go ahead and share my screen.
Okay.
Share. Okay. That should do it. And here we are. So thank you very much for the look at task one. We can look at the next stage here, task two, which is Springs integration and improvement. We had talked with the LCC and some of their partners a bit about the Springs data that are available. There's a couple of interesting and very detailed data sets available in Arizona that could play a big role in helping update NHD. Jumping to the bottom bullets here, there's a couple of groups here, the Springs Stewardship Institute and Sky Island group Springs databases that we have here. Sky Island's data are shown here in blue in southeastern Arizona. You can see there's quite a few of these springs available. Springs Stewardship Institute has springs for a larger extent of the state, really Arizona and beyond, I believe. And both data sets have a lot of detail about the springs. Their location, of course, the name, information on flow, and associated vegetation and wildlife species. So there's a lot of information to be gleaned from this. And we do have Springs features in NHD, so some of the data here could be migrated into NHD. That would improve our data set. Now, NHD, however, is a public data set, as Joel said, so certain Springs information and certain Springs themselves may be sensitive, so we would not want to put any data from sensitive springs into NHD since it's regularly accessed by the public. So we would have to work that out. But right now we're just starting to look at what springs we want to look at, how feasible is this, and where could we start to update the NHD data. Okay, so the next steps are we'll look at the priority and areas for spring integration. Do we stick kind of the Sky Islands area, southeastern Arizona, do we go a little further north, where task three is going to take place with those several additional hydrologic units. So we're not quite sure exactly how to do that. So we'll work with DLC to make that decision very shortly and get that squared away. One of the things to note too, as Joel pointed out earlier, we have most of the funding allocated for task three is assigned to several different HUCs, hydrologic units in the Madrean area. Not all of it has been allocated, however, and depending on how we can work with the springs, maybe some of that money could go towards integrating additional springs data into NHD. And with that in mind, let's take a quick look here at the at some of the springs data. Okay, Joel and his group have downloaded some of the springs data, and I have too for a brief demo. They're going to look at it, of course, in much more detail than I am. But what I did was download data for one 8-digit HUC in southeastern Arizona. This is from the Spring Stewardship Institute. And what I've done is bring in really two data sets, NHD data, the large orange dots are NHD springs points, and the yellow ones are from the Institute. Okay, red, I wouldn't worry about them. Those are wells. I brought them in because there's a little bit of coincidence between some springs and wells. But let's take a look here at some of the data. This will be interesting to look at. How do we work on this? As it slowly loads, here we go. You can see, for example, in here, a lot of these springs information, both from NHD and other places, came from old topo sheets. Okay, so the topos would have a spring location on there, very little information. From there, it can get picked up by NHD, picked up by others. So you do see a fair number of springs that people are finding are also kind of co-noted in the topo sheets as well. But there are new ones as well, other springs, okay, that will come from the Sky Islands or the Spring Stewardship Institutes. They have a lot more information. So for example, we can take a look at the attribution. As I said before, the NHD is fairly minimally attributed. The spring here has some basic information. When was it included in NHD, various codes to identify it. It does have a name, it's called Creature Spring, okay? Many of these do not have a name, this one does. And then it has a certain code to identify it as a spring, okay? And that's about it. Information though from the Institute, okay, it has a lot more information. It's got the same name, it's got its own coding information, and further details as you can see on here. We don't need to go into all of them, but suffice it to say, there's a lot more information on it. We wouldn't want all that in NHD because we can't hold much, but it would be certainly nice to have updated locations, information on the status of the spring, et cetera, you know, from these other data sets. Here's another spring, okay? We don't have that in NHD, it's not on the topo map, but this is new data. And a lot of the times, you can see by the dates here, 2014, that this information is new. People have looked at it or worked with the data recently with that. A lot of the USGS data came from, again, topo maps, which in some cases may be a number of years old. So this information here is generally more up to date. So this is interesting to look at this. You see a fair amount of coincidence in here between the two different data sets, but trying to find out exactly how to approach this and which ones to bring in and examine this. We'll be working on that. Joel, those of us at USGS, as well as the folks with Sky Islands and the Springs Institute. So you can see differences in locations of a lot of the springs, okay? For example, here's a zoom in. Here's the USGS spring. Here's the Institute's one. Given that this may be newer data, this may well be the better location. This is on an old topo sheet again. Some of those topo sheets might have had their origins at 1 to 24K, which is going to be plus or minus roughly 40 feet right at that scale. So depending on the GPS accuracy at how it's collected, this may well be better. It looks like in this instance, for example, it's closer to the bottom of this channel. Okay, so this is probably a good point for that. So it's interesting just to look at this and see where we're going to go. There's an old spring here, but no newer one. Maybe this one doesn't exist anymore, it's dried up. I don't know, but things to look at. The main thing is, this is a good thing to have. It's good that we have all this data out there, that this will only serve to make the NHD better. Okay. And so I think that's about all the time we have for that. So Joel, let me stop sharing this. Okay, we see your screen.
Great, thanks, Drew. So like Drew mentioned, there are a couple options, and that we'll be discussing the different options for the Springs integration, which data sets or data set we use, and where we end up integrating Springs or improving Springs in the NHD. It depends on DLCC's feedback. That's something that we'll be working with them. And also, I wanted to plug in that that discussion point from task two into task three. Again, I've already talked about task three and how we do have some areas left over to be allocated. So there's flexibility here. So for instance, if springs are very critical and high priority for DLCC and their science objectives, instead of carrying out comprehensive updates to an area equating to the 1,200 that are left under task two, there's always a possibility to transfer the amount left in terms of the area here and kind of translate that into additional spring integration if, again, the DLCC deems that to be something that's high priority. So there's still flexibility, but that will be discussed with the DLCC in the near future. And like I mentioned for task three, these areas were locked in last month by DLCC, so we've started working on improving these areas, and they should be completed over the next several months. And like I mentioned too, going back to our business rules and our workflow standards, they will help feed into those standards and help future efforts as well. All right, so kind of to wrap up the webinar, we wanted to take the opportunity of having all of you on the webinar with us to also touch on two related efforts that deal with NHD and that are also relevant because they're tied into the area that we're updating for the DLCC project. So first up is Region 3 U.S. Forest Service. Candace Bogart, who I think is on this webinar here with us today, they're currently discussing and planning on executing two possible scopes of work. There's their own scope of work, which deals with seasonality updates to streams, and there's also a component where water body names would be integrated into the NHD using a new provisional name tool. So that's what reflects their scope, and then another point of discussion or another consideration, too, is also bringing comprehensive updates in line with the DLCC scope of work or the scope of the project that would bring updates, geometry updates, and additions to points, lines, and polygons, and in addition, also capture the U.S. Forest Service scope, so the attribution updates to seasonality and the integration of names. So these are kind of two general approaches that US Forest Service are currently considering. And I just wanted to mention the relevance here being that there are potential efficiencies with overlapping or adjacent watersheds. Let me bring up the map again, and you can see here, we've in the kind of dark gray outline, we have the U.S. Forest Service lands in the green. You can see here there, again, looking at the Task 3 watersheds in blue that are being updated under this DLCC project, they are adjacent and in some cases overlap with U.S. Forest Service lands. So if the timing works out nicely, there are efficiencies that can be built in there, and each project can have benefits from one another. And with that, Drew will wrap it up talking about the stream reclassification.
Okay, thanks. Here we go to wrap up. And hang on here. Simpler to just go ahead with this way. So what we're doing now is a update to the stream classification. Joel talked about the seasonality of the data, and what we're working on here is really updating the classification of these streams. I showed you the perennial, intermittent, and ephemeral streams before. And we did not have the ephemeral classification in NHD until about 10 years ago. So the roots of NHD come from the topo sheet, so a lot of our maps only had a perennial or an intermittent component to them. And so what we're doing now is trying to move a lot of the smaller streams that were really ephemeral all along from intermittent to ephemeral. Okay, so we have a fairly simple algorithm that was used to do this. The reasoning behind that was to get these done quickly, because this is an issue that's been around for a long time and people have been inquiring about when we could update these. So what we tried to do was rapidly update them pretty much by grabbing the smaller intermittent streams, those without names, and then switching them within the arid and semi-arid hydrologic units from intermittent to ephemeral. Okay, so this was applied directly by USGS. And this is a good kind of starting point for further comprehensive edits. Not only the kind of very detailed stuff that Joel's doing, but there may be a few streams that need to be reclassified after this kind of bulk adjustment. As you can see here, this map may not show up very well on the screen, but it shows a lot of the HUCs under consideration in the Southwest. These are the HUCs that contain average precipitation of 17 inches or less. Not all of these would necessarily be converted like this, because a number of these are quite mountainous, but this gives you kind of an idea where we're starting to look. For the areas now more affecting what we're working on with this project, you can see Arizona kind of in the brown purple, and most of these have been converted now, along with some of the Southern California HUCs as well. So we're just starting to see how well this is working out, but again, the aim here is to change the vast majority of these intermittent streams that really weren't, changing them now to ephemeral. So that's kind of what we've been doing, and as this goes on with this project, Joel and everybody will just kind of work through this. And some of the streams, hopefully this has made things easier by making intermittent ephemeral, but maybe some of those that got switched ephemeral really should be back in and intermittent, and that's okay. We can use local knowledge and information from his experience to adjust these as they need to be. And I think that just about wraps it up. I'll go ahead to the final question slide and stop here.
All right, well, thank you very much to Joel and Drew for this presentation. We do have a few minutes for questions here, so if you do have something to ask one of our presenters, please use that raise your hand function in the webinar, and we will call on you by name, at which point you can unmute yourself and ask your question. All right, we'll give folks a second here just to see if they have any questions or if they're figuring out how to raise their hand. And again, once you get called on, if you press star 6, that will unmute your line and you'll be able to speak.
Yeah, Ken, can I add to that that the raise hand button, in case those of you are looking for it, it's at the top of the participation list. Should be next to your name. There's a little icon with a hand, and if you hover over it, it says raise hand.
Perfect. Thank you.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, who's this?
This is Candace. I was raising my hand, but I don't know if it was working or not. I sure appreciated your slides and your careful and excellent explanations today. I was wondering if we could get a copy of the presentation. I thought it was very helpful.
Yeah, absolutely, Candace. We can forward that to you. We've been in previous discussions, so we'll just go ahead and forward that.
Thank you. Thank you.
And as a reminder, this entire presentation, the recorded portion, will be made available on the YouTube channel of the DLCC. So, in addition to having those materials, you'll also be able to hear Drew and Joel talking through the work, which of course will be valuable as well.
Hi, this is Shay Burns. I tried raising my hand as well, but it doesn't look like it was seen, and I've got a few questions.
Please go ahead.
Okay, is the update standardizing the attribution of the different classes? Because I've seen examples where, like the flow line feature class, for example, has the permanent identifier field, where sometimes it has a 36 character alphanumeric string, and other times it has like a 9 character numeric string. And then sometimes there's a COM ID field that's present, and sometimes there's not, and the same with the GNS ID.
So this is true, because I have a few words on that. The COM IDs are going away, and the permanent ID will be used for features from here on. The length of that ID does vary, and usually it's quite long. I'm not, you know, I'd have to check with somebody, or maybe Joel would know, on the varying lengths of that. The GNS ID, by the way, will only be available if the name is in the GNIS database, which is accessible, by the way. People can search for names, which is kind of interesting to do that. But each officially named feature will have its own ID, and so those two pieces of information, if they're available, will be in NHD. But then again, there's an awful lot of features in there that are not named at all and probably will not be.
And to add to that, Drew, throughout our active updates to the NHD in these areas, we're not actively updating specifically those IDs. Those IDs change automatically when we're using the USGS NHD update tools. Whenever there's a, like an addition of a new feature, for example, a new PERM ID is generated. But whenever we modify, realign, reshape, or update like the seasonality, the F code, F type attribution, that doesn't necessarily result in a modification or an update or a change to the PERM IDs or the GNIS names or IDs. Those are left intact as long as it was an original feature that had those IDs to begin with.
Can I ask another question? This is Bill Shea.
Sure.
Are you guys thinking about the push to integrate with 3DEP and how your update process will change when, you know, moving forward with that?
Yeah, this is true. We don't really have standards for that per se. We are moving kind of forward with the Ella Hydro, which is a combo of the two together. So as the 3DEP begins to you know, produce more product, we are working actively now to kind of nail down the procedures and how we would work to generate hydro at the same time or in conjunction with this. Right now, they're still separate, but everybody knows that, you know, the links between the two are very strong and they can be produced together. So that's still something we're working on.
And I see we have two other questions if we have just a minute to answer them. We have Lindsay Reynolds' hand is up. If you're still with us, Lindsay, go ahead and unmute and you can ask your question.
Hi, this is Lindsay Reynolds. Thank you. My question has to do with the new wetlands that you've been identifying in the Imperial watershed. And I'm just curious if you're doing any on the ground truthing, because I'm wondering if some of those might be pretty transitory according to water management in the specific reach. And so I'm curious, you know, how on what spatial and temporal scale you guys are concerned about those wetlands, you know, whether they're just blinking in and out depending on water management.
That's a very good question. Unfortunately, we are not doing field verifications. We would love to, but it's not part of the scope of the project. We did give close consideration in developing the business rules for mapping wetland features. Currently, what our workflow kind of is set up to do is walks our editors through the assessment of several different reference features or reference feature data sets. We look at the most recent NAEP aerial photos that are available to us, and then we also cross-check those aerial photos with different aerial photo sources. So we look at Bing Maps, we look at Google Maps, we look at Google Earth. We use the temporal option to switch to older dates in Google Earth when it's required to give us further confidence in our mapping and our assessments. And then on top of that, we also use, like I mentioned before, the National Wetlands Inventory data. Whenever they've classified emergent wetlands, that's something that that we pay close attention to. So we use those different data sets kind of to drive our decision making. And we do have a policy that whenever something is kind of like in the gray area and we're uncertain, especially when it comes to wetlands, features that are likely to change in drier regions, we don't end up adding those. We end up adding features that we have high confidence in their presence being there and being more or less permanent features or more prominent features in the landscape or the current environment. So that's currently what kind of like our workflow. And unfortunately, we don't have ground truth data. We don't have supplied data that can verify kind of the level or how prominent those wetlands may be. So again, we have to, at the very least, account for those that seem more or less prominent given the different data sets that we are assessing and analyzing.
Okay, great. That's great to hear some more details. I have one other question on the newly classified ephemeral reaches, and I'm curious if in the algorithm that you're using to determine ephemeral reaches, if that is tied at all to the presence of springs, because I can think of you know, I can imagine that there would be a small high headwater reach that would be normally classified as ephemeral, but if it's tied to a spring, it may be perennial.
This is Drew. As far as I know, that springs were not taken account into that, but that's a great point that you raised, because yes, I would expect that certain springs, you know, could support a intermittent, if not perennial, flow out there. Probably not many, as you said, but I think it's something we definitely want to look at. So yeah, that will be something we want to look at to kind of readjust, you might say, some of the streams that have been reclassified. So that springs data will be really important to look at.
Yeah, and Drew, to kind of add to that and kind of make it a little bit more clear, that algorithm was run directly to the national database. It was run on the back end, and it automatically converted any unnamed intermittent stream in these arid areas into ephemeral. So the thinking there was that was kind of like the starting point. And so what we're doing in our work under this project is we're taking the data, having had that change and that conversion already done to it, And our kind of like our goals are to look for instances like that. So whenever we now go in and look and see and identify ephemerals that may be closely or in close proximity or being, you know, directly fed by a spring that in actuality are not ephemeral and are likely more intermittent, our work will go ahead and change those ephemerals that should obviously not be ephemeral, should be intermittent to us based off our assessments, and change those into intermittent. So the thinking there is apply the algorithm first, have that as kind of like your foundation, and then move in, do the specific comprehensive updates, and kind of build and improve coming out of those mass changes that occurred.
Okay, great. Thanks a lot. I enjoyed that.
Thank you.
And if we have time, and Mark Horner is still with us, Mark, go ahead and unmute yourself, and I think that'll be our last question.
Yes, thank you. You answered it with a wetland workflow. That was my question as well. Could you also, and secondarily, are there any notions on after task three from this point? Are you have any plans to go into New Mexico or in other areas?
There is a possibility, yeah. The DLCC, it's essentially, it's up to the DLCC where they deem their priority areas are that should receive NHD updates under this project. So far, we've talked mostly about areas within Arizona, but like I mentioned, under Task 3, there's a chunk of area left over, but it's really ultimately up to the DLCC where the area will be allocated. But New Mexico, Texas, the DLCC region does span across several states, so those are fair game. As long as nobody else is doing updates currently or no one has previously conducted recent updates to those areas, obviously.
Okay, thank you.
Well, thank you everyone for participating, and thank you especially to Drew and Joel and for staying on a little bit longer to finish answering some questions. The webinar, again, as a reminder, will be made available through the Desert Landscape Conservation Cooperative YouTube channel. So please go ahead and look for that in a few weeks, and there'll be an email sent out as well. And I'd like to just thank everyone for participating one more time, and have a great day.